Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes.
Hi there, this is Richard Rothstein, and today we're going to be talking to Pasha Malik, and Pasha is with Thyor, and we're going to be talking again about recruiting. Morning, Pasha, how are you doing today?
Pretty good, Richard, how are you?
Good. So could you tell me, before we kind of get started, could you tell me a little bit about your firm and what you guys do?
Yeah. So Thyor is kind of like an overarching consulting firm that I kind of co-founded. And I'll lead the practice side and the client relationship side. And we have an accounting and CFO and tax side of the business. And we have a technology and data science arm. Because we found that as accountants, we are come across a lot of valuable data that gets looked over. So that was kind of like an opportunity for us to like branch out and bring a lot more, be a more modern firm, bring in more technology into our solutions. And we're seeing a lot of that with especially our mid-sized business clients, where they're getting a lot of valuable advice from us that they can take action on. It's something that we're still working on with small business clients because this is data science and is a pretty expensive offering. So we're still working on bringing the price point down so it's more accessible to a lot more people and businesses.
Oh, that's really cool. That's really neat. I mean, it makes sense that, you know, as accountants, you see a lot of the data points that are important for business to know for all kinds of business. So it makes sense to bring a data science approach to that. That's really cool. Well, cool. So how are you, knowing that, how are you handling recruiting for specifically accountants, but also people on your data science side before COVID?
So we've always been 100% remote team, but we still had offices and we used places like WeWork all around the US to be our hubs, where we would have conference calls, client meetings, in-person meetings, whatever we needed to do. But when it came to hiring, it was mostly through professional recruitments, recruiting firms, because we found better, more experienced clients, more experienced accountants and data scientists to work with. It was also better for us to actually have a conversation with those potential recruits to understand what they're looking for and also understand how they think, how they solve problems, how they approach them. Because for us, it's a lot about when clients come to us, they don't say they want an accountant or what or X or Y or Z. They tell us what the problem is and they want a solution to it. So we have to figure out a solution for it. So we, at the core of it, we need really good problem solvers who understand everything, not everything, but to a great deal about the client's industry, what market they operate in, where they want to be, what are the challenges, what industry challenges there are. So it'll be a little more forward thinking, it'll be more entrepreneurial into thinking. I'm sure you know, like as accountants, we come across this habit of falling into the status quo where we stop thinking in an entrepreneurial way for the good of the client's businesses. We're more thinking about from a compliance centric mindset, which is, I'm sure works for some clients, but in this dynamic age and dynamic market, you need very forward-thinking entrepreneurial mindsets and be very aggressive about what solutions you're creating for the clients.
That's cool. So through,
recruitment firms, we would hire people.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So you got that way through recruitment firms. Were there any particular like channels you're using to generate applicants? I mean, really just the recruitment firms, or were there any others that were kind of note?
LinkedIn and Twitter served really well for us. I personally hang out a lot on Twitter and LinkedIn, and there's a lot of really in-depth conversations that are happening in those circles. Twitter more so. So when you're having those conversations and you're in that circle or sphere or bubble, I should say, you kind of have a lot bigger network beyond what your region is. And when you have, when you need to, so for example, in my circle on the data science, so their accountants on Twitter, if I need to hire an accountant, say for who's an expert in partnership taxes for real estate funds, for example, in my conversations with other accountants on Twitter, I'll reach out to them and ask them if they know of anyone. And quite often you will, they will know. Those people are the best networks that you can get because they know how much knowledge somebody has.
Oh, that's great. So do you find that those work better than recruiters, or, and you're just not able to kind of scale it super well, or is it just kind of when you need somebody that you're having trouble with a recruiter?
It's a mix. So I wouldn't say one is better than the other, because recruitment is all about spreading your net. The wider your net, the more the odds are, the better you might get, better recruits you might get. But I think for recruiters, it's also how well they understand what you're looking for. Or quite often I've come across, they don't really understand and they give you a general list of candidates that they just want you to go through. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So for us, quite often when we're looking for someone, we have certain projects in the pipeline and we know what we need for that. And so we have a very specific requirement of what skill set we are looking for in the next person. So that usually happens. That usually is works better on Twitter, I guess. But on LinkedIn, I have a pretty wide network on LinkedIn too. So for me, I've been pretty lucky in that sense. Mm-hmm. Before COVID, I was participating in a lot of networking events, a lot of masterminds, interacting with a lot of other firms, partners. And that was, for me, I didn't really have much of a problem in recruitment. I think the problem more was finding the right problem-solving candidates. Mm-hmm. So it's like, especially in the DC area, there's a lot of candidates who are more from the compliance and the government mindset. So, and you find a lot of really creative entrepreneurial accountants or data scientists who are more in the on the West Coast, because mm-hmm. most of them get picked up by startups or like big tech firms.
So do you think that focus on more problem solving and more entrepreneurial versus the focus on compliance, do you think that's something that more firms should look to?
I think it matters on what the firm's business model is. I know for our business model, we are very heavily focused on problem solving, strategy work, a lot of planning work, a lot of like solution driven work, mm-hmm. Like value creation. Compliance is extremely necessary. Don't get me wrong that compliance is not necessary, but I think there's a big trend of commoditization of compliance work, mm-hmm. where you see a lot of accountants, especially going into compliance work. And even when they start their careers at a lot of these firms, they are siloed into compliance work. And very few get the opportunity to experience really creative work, whether they're doing strategy work, planning work. So I think it's more from a very early stage. I'm seeing this a lot more with new candidates who have more awareness, especially who have good mentorship. That when they go join the new firms, they are more vocal about what they want, and they're more demanding of the firm's career development process. Mm-hmm. But for people who have been into that system for a really long time, I think a lot of them either give up and just take on compliance work because that's where they think the career is. Mm-hmm. And they have it's hard for them to do a pivot later in life. Even though I think they should. I mean, they have a really good knowledge base on the compliance. You need to know the compliance work in order to do the strategy work. It doesn't work without that.
Right. So this sounds really interesting. I actually haven't really heard of another accounting firm that had a data science side. How did that kind of affect how long people stay with your company? I mean, do people stay with longer? I mean, less time? I mean, what have you seen?
So far, we haven't seen, I would say, turnover in that sense. we have a really good work-life balance. We have 3-day weekends. Everybody has the complete flexibility that they want in terms of setting their own hours. We're more concerned with project delivery, meeting the deadlines, that kind of stuff. We don't do billable hours. When we're picking up new clients and new projects, once we figured out what the structure of the project is and what the pricing and costing is going to be, we're pretty transparent about that with our team. The team that's going to be working on it, we tell them, okay, this is what we're charging the client. This is how much our fee is going to be. This is how much the resource and hours requirement is going to be. Can you fit this in? And how would you fit this in? Show us your schedule. Let us know whether it works for you or not. So the flexibility that we provide everybody in our team to make their own projects is something that's a really big plus for a lot of them. Because they can, if they're feeling like they really want to be challenged and want to work on exciting stuff, we have that. Mm-hmm. If some days or some weeks or months they're feeling like I'm not in that mindset, mm-hmm. and they just want to do like low level challenging work, that's fine too. We have that work also. So we allow them that flexibility. But the majority of our team is very dynamic. So we don't really have that problem of somebody taking a backseat. Like everybody's like, yeah, we want this. It's more about whether their work-life balance fits into it.
Wow, that's great. So you have, it sounds like, you know, you guys, you said you're remote from day one, that you make sure you have a good work-life balance. I mean, has anything changed for you guys, you know, since COVID? I mean, it sounds like you guys were pretty well set up for the challenges.
In some way, yes. Yes, we were ready for those challenges. But I think what a lot of us didn't really plan for or understand was how much, when people are like stuck at homes with their family commitments 24/7 while they have to work, that is a whole new set of challenge that probably nobody even thought of. Previously in that setup, people, for example, who did have kids, their kids are off at school or daycare. So they're not really worried about it because they can even stay at home and work or be at a remote work location like a WeWork and work from there. Now, WeWork is not an option. They have to stay home and work because a lot of places are still under lockdown. They have to take care of their families. They can't expose their families to the risk of COVID by going out. So that 24/7 with the kids, with family, sometimes even extended family who's come home to stay, or a lot of them are actually staying with their parents because their parents are elderly and they need care. So I think that dynamic has put a little more pressure on a lot of them where they feel like there is one continuous kind of like workload, whether it's work related or not, that doesn't give them a chance to de-stress. So I think that's a challenge that we as a firm have not been able to solve, but we've been more flexible in understanding where somebody is having certain issues or challenges with what they're dealing with in the personal. We give them a certain break. We tell them, okay, take 1 or 2 days off let's circle back again. We've been more understanding of that part. It's been a challenge, but I think those problems are going to continue being a challenge because I don't know if we really can solve those problems for our team.
That's honest. You know, that is probably a big problem that I don't know how you solve that problem for people.
Yeah.
You kind of said, talking a little bit about that and kind of what challenges are now. You know, what do you expect the recruiting situation to look like a year from now?
I think with 2021, I personally think that we're going to be doing, in our firm, we'll be doing a lot more hiring. We have some, so before 2020, we did quite a lot of hiring because we had a lot of projects in the pipeline. Quite a few of those projects didn't come through. They got suspended because of what happened in 2020 because they were not as feasible. So we're hoping they're going to kickstart again in 2021 once things normalize, whatever that means. So we will be doing a lot of recruiting in 2021. But I guess the biggest challenge in 2021 would be a lot of the clients that we are, potential clients that we came across, whose businesses suffered extensively. Like, I know we worked with quite a few clients who had bankruptcies or were close to bankruptcies. They didn't file for one, but they were in pretty dire situations. So restructuring those businesses to be more, to embrace the challenge and be more prepared for what the new economy is going to look like and the new market is going to look like. I think we did a lot of work for our existing clients where we, starting in March and April, we started restructuring the business and told them, hey, if you're going to not only succeed, but thrive in this new dynamic, you need to change the way you do things. So the ones that embraced it, they've been doing pretty well. The ones that did not, the majority of them have had a pretty hard time. But I think that changing that mindset of the founders and the business owners is still going to be a challenge. Making them understand that the economy has changed, the way our society functions has changed. And while things may return to normalization when vaccinations are maybe the majority of our population is vaccinated, but it's still going to be a big challenge to get the clients to do or customers to do doing things the way they used to.
Cool. Yeah. No, I mean, I can totally agree. I understand that. That's makes a lot of sense that, you know, clients themselves are really kind of seeing, hey, well, we can do it this way. Why are we going back to the old way?
Yeah.
You know, so finally, what advice do you have for other firms that are looking to hire these days?
Most of them are from my own experiences when I used to work for other firms. I know every, especially the newer generation, that the new recruits that we have, they absolutely hate the concept of billable hours. I know even my partners that I used to work with when I was at a consulting firms, even they did not like the concept of billable hours, but that's how they were trained. And that's just the mindset that they had. So I think that concept needs to be thrown away. We really need to change the way our firms function in terms of how to value our resources, especially our human resources. Mm-hmm. That intellectual capital is something that needs to be valued in a much different way than on an hourly basis. The second part would be to allow more flexibility. I think remote work should be the norm. We've built our firm on remote work culture. I always tell people I have a person in my team who actually lives and works from Bali. And he often sends me a picture of him sitting on the beach with a laptop in his lap and a beer bottle on his in his hand. And he sends me a picture and he captions it, rough commute.
That's
so
awesome.
Yeah, so I'm like, one thing that this year has told us that every work can be done remotely. Mm-hmm. There is no need for our 2 hour long conference meetings. And I think that mindset needs to be changed. Flexibility. I think flexibility is the one key thing that really needs to be incorporated more into our firm's business models. Allow people to take the lead of developing their own careers, take their own direction, and make them more proactive. The sooner that happens, the more, and allow them to make mistakes, because the more, once they make the mistakes, they'll learn from it and they'll grow more. Somebody who hasn't made a mistake, they're not really growing. Or they haven't really done anything that's challenging enough to make a mistake.
Awesome. That's great advice, Pasha. Well, thank you so much for sitting down with us. I'm Richard. Nice to see everybody. And thank you so much for sitting with us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. We hope you'll rate and review us wherever you find your podcasts to help other accountants find our show more easily. For more information, you can go to CPATrendlines.com.